Chapter 30, Mandate, from the Canons of the Kings and from other councils given on mandate. Anyone who adheres in every respect to the rules regarding his soul and to the laws is worthy of being appointed a mandatory. A mandate may extend to all affairs and judgments, or may be given with respect to a specific object, to the exclusion of others. The mandatory accepts the mandate with or without remuneration. If the object of the mandator perishes in the hands of the mandatory without fraud or negligence on the latter's part, he shall not pay. A mandate is not valid unless the mandatory gives it verbally, and the mandatory accepts the word of the mandator, either formally or by his actions. The mandatory must not sell anything on credit unless the mandator has ordered him to, nor must he sell anything for more or for less than its price. If the mandator says to him, "Sell some of my property on credit," he must sell immediately. The mandatory shall not buy from the mandator any silver object different from that which he ordered orally or by letter. And if his mandator has said to him, "Buy something worth 1,000 dinars for me immediately," the mandatory may buy it on credit at the price of 1,000 dinars. And if the mandatory is instructed to keep what he has bought, he must return it to the mandator if it becomes defective while it is in his hands. And if he has given the object to his mandator, he shall not retake it without the mandator's order. In case the mandator says, "Buy for me with your own money," or "Give me oil worth 1,000 dinars from what you have, and I will pay you in the future," he must buy it for him. The oil shall belong to the mandator, who may use it only after he has paid the price. The 1,000 dinars shall be given to the mandatory when the time for payment is due, and the oil shall remain with him as a pledge of the price. If the mandatory has bought something for the mandator with his own money, but without the mandator's order, the object he bought shall remain in the hands as a pledge. If he is instructed to buy a specific thing, he may not buy that object for himself, nor may he take for himself without permission what he bought on behalf of the mandator who appointed him mandatory, especially if he used the mandator's money. The mandatory must not defraud the mandator in the thing sold, saying that he has sold it for less than its actual price, or in the thing bought, saying he hath bought it for a price higher than it actually cost at the time and place of the bargain. He must make an accounting according to the price agreed to by the buyer and the seller, an accounting which is more or less according to the estimation of experienced persons. In particular, the mandatory must not make fraudulent contracts with the family of the mandator, his father, his son, grandson, or his wife, to the prejudice of the mandator. If the mandator gives 1 dinar to the mandatory to buy a sheep for him, but he buys with a dinar 2 sheep, each worth 1 dinar, both shall belong to the mandator. If the mandator tells the mandatory to sell something to a certain person at a fixed price, having no desire other than selling the object, the mandatory may sell it to another person provided that he is sure about the price. If there are no witnesses to testify in a dispute, the mandatory's word shall be accepted, since the mandator has entrusted his goods to him. If he has paid a debt on behalf of his mandator in the latter's absence, but has obtained no witnesses to testify to the payment, and if afterwards the creditor denies having been paid, the mandatory must pay the debt. If the mandatory has deposited an object with another person, he must tell the depositee that the object belongs to the mandator. In the case where a man acts as mandatory for property owned by 2 persons, neither of the owners may dispose of the property individually except in cases of gratuitous manumission of a slave, nor could one of them give a command concerning the jointly owned property without the consent of the other, or pay personal debt out of the jointly owned property. The one who buys a slave must record his purchase in a book. The mandatory may not delegate his mandate to another person without an order from his mandator, although if he wishes to go on a journey or necessity requires, he is not to be prevented from designating someone to assume his mandate until his return. A mandate shall not be taken away from the mandatory, unless with the consent of the mandator, but shall remain until the day fixed for its termination. And the mandatory shall not give up the mandate of his own will, but must remain as mandatory as long as the mandator wishes, and then until he transfers the administration to his mandator, so that the mandator may administer his property himself or find another mandatory like him. Under no other circumstances may the mandatory give up his mandate if one of them abandons his administration because of death, or if there is another master who takes the mandator's place over the mandatory, the mandate ceases whether the other approves or not. And if the mandatory becomes afflicted with grave insanity, or proves incapable through blindness or such thing, the mandate ceases whether the mandator approves or not. Chapter 31. Liberty, Slavery, and the Manumitted. The major part of this chapter is extracted from the Canons of the Kings. The state of liberty is in accord with the law of reason, for all men share liberty on the basis of natural law. But war and the strength of horses bring some to the service of others, because the law of war and of victory makes the vanquished slaves of the victors. Mosaic law shows that unbelievers and their children must be held as slaves, since it is written there, "Those whom you take from the people who dwell around you, and the aliens who dwell among you, let them, men and women, be your slaves. You shall buy slaves from among them, and from among their offspring born in your land, and they shall be for you and your children after you as an inheritance. The sale of a believing slave to an unbeliever is not allowed. The children of a slave belong to their master. Be they born from a free woman or from a female slave, the child of a female slave belongs to her master, whether he is born from a free man or from a slave, and regardless whether he was born from a union by marriage or from fornication with someone other than her master. In case she becomes free during her pregnancy, the child in her womb is free, because a mother was freed while she was carrying him in her womb. One may set free the child in the womb without setting free the one who is pregnant. The child of a once free woman born from a free father or from a slave who was manumitted is free, even if she became a slave after she conceived him and before she gave birth to him, because the enslavement of another must not affect one's state of freedom. To manumit a slave is one of the deeds of perfection which must be done, for it is an excellent form of alms. It is the granting to a man of the right to become master of himself, according to the original law of his natural liberty. A manumission is not valid unless the slave is given his liberty by his master. If he promised to manumit him on some condition, he may sell the slave before the fulfillment of the condition he set. If he buys him a second time, this condition ceases to have effect until he renews it. If he sets a definite time in the future for her manumission, she is not in a state of slavery, but must serve him until the time of her manumission. She is master of herself, and may do whatever is advantageous to her, and not against her interest. One who is manumitted shall serve his master's son for a definite number of years after his manumission. But the manumitter may not impose on him and his offspring the obligation to serve him and his descendants during their lifetime, nor may he demand that all their earnings be given to them, since this would be a way of continuing his slavery. Manumission is effected by declaring it publicly in the church or before the bishop, or before the priest, or before three witnesses. It may also be effected by a letter or by a written will. If it is by the will of the manumitter, the rules of succession govern it, and the manumission may concern all the slaves or particular ones. If one has three slaves and manumits one, he is within his right in doing so. If he decides to sell the others, he may do this. Moreover, a manumission may be effected either by giving full liberty to the slave or by freeing a part of him. The one who retains a third part of his slave and frees him as regards the other two thirds may do this. If he wants to buy the entirety of a slave he owns jointly with others, and to give him his liberty, his partners must sell their shares of the slave to him for the proper price, and when he owns the slave entirely, he shall set him free. The price of a slave is like that of an object at any given time. It may increase or decrease. It increases in proportion to his hand's ability and decreases in proportion to his ignorance and his advancement in age. One must buy a Christian slave from non-Christian owners at the proper price. There are 7 cases in which a slave must be set free from his master. 1. He must be set free if he was owned as a slave by one of the master's parents and one of his grandparents, or by one of the master's children and his grandson, or by the master's brother and one of the latter's heirs. And if a man is part owner of a slave, so that there is another who shares ownership, if one of them is a rich man, he must buy him entirely and set him entirely free. 2. If the master of his wife becomes the slave's godfather or godmother, or if the master's daughter, with her parents' knowledge, becomes his grandmother, or if the slave becomes a priest with his master's permission, or if he becomes a monk, he shall be set free. 3. If his master makes him a soldier, he must set him free. 4. If the slave saves his master from being killed by fighting for him or warning him against danger, the master must set him free in compensation. 5. If a woman who is pregnant is set free, her child is also free. 6. If a slave has been put in jail by the enemy and afterwards returns to his master of his own will, he deserves to be set free. 7. If a slave's master dies, leaving no heir except the slave's mistress or the state, the slave shall be set free. And if one would manumit his slave for God's sake, or for any other reason, whether the slave is loved or hated, the latter deserves his freedom. If a free man who has obtained 20 years of age confesses to having bonds of slavery to another, consent to be sold, and then persist in this confession, so much so that his purported master sells him or gives him away as dowry to his wife, he becomes a slave. Especially is this so if it is said that he has agreed with the one who sold him on his price. But if he has not attained this age, the judge and the governor must release him from the hand of the one he acknowledged as master, or from the hand of the one who bought him. He must be set free. A slave who has been freed must return into slavery when it is proved before the judge that he insulted his master, or beat him, or beat his children without his permission, or ruined his master's property with the help of others, with the intention to harm him, especially if he caused injury to life within his master's family. He must be treated according to the command of the Mosaic law. A master shall not give his slave liberty, but then make him go out naked of his wealth. A free woman must not marry a slave. Never shall she dwell with him in the house of his master, nor shall she make him dwell with her with the consent of his master. If she does these things, she shall be the slave of his master, like him. The one who corrupts the slave of another, which does not belong to him, or hides him and sends him away, must bring him back to his owner and give the owner, in addition, another slave or the equivalent price. The same applies to the one who takes with him the slave of another, which does not belong to him, and who makes him his slave, well aware that he belongs to another. If the taker cannot provide the equivalent price, he shall be the slave of the slave's true master. Chapter 32, Guardianship, taken from the Aptalis and similar sources. 2 things require guardianship. First, guardianship is necessary for the one who is unable to distinguish in his mind that which is suitable for the perfection of his nature and good for his will. This inability may arise either because of an evil spirit which seduces him, this is the mad person, or because his brain is wrecked by disease, this is the feeble-minded person, who forgets his previous actions, or because his brain is not mature. This is the boy who has not attained the age of 18 years, or because his mental condition becomes more feeble than previously by nature, because of the use made of his brain. This is the case of any man when he grows old and approaches 100 years of age. Or it might be that the previous condition of a man's brain was healthy and perfect, but he did not use it properly, as in the case of the indolent. And such is the case of he who has used his brain for useless works in this world and in the future world. This is the one who is dissolute in his behavior and with respect to his wealth, like the spendthrift who wastes and squanders his property. Such a person must be prohibited things, or such a person must be watched over carefully, lest he also become dissolute in his faith, as by wearing prohibited things or by seeking many pleasures. The reputation of a dissolute man is in opposition to that of the wise man. Second, guardianship is necessary, for a situation which hinders an intelligent being from guarding himself and his property, such as that of a slave. No person who is under guardianship, because he is either mad, demented, a minor, or aged and absent-minded because of his advanced age, may enter into negotiations regarding the conclusion of marriage, or give a trustworthy word on his own behalf or on behalf of others. A foolish or dissolute man may be permitted to dispose of his own property on his guardian's command, but may not dispose of other people's property. A slave may dispose of his property only on his master's order, and after he is set free, he may confess that he was his slave. And if guardians lose anything of their ward's property, they shall repay it. If one who is under guardianship draws up a regular and legal will during his sickness, it shall be valid after his death, even if he was mad or demented. But if the will departs from the requirements of a regular and legal will, only what the governor and judge ratify of it shall be valid. The natural guardian is the ward's father, if he himself is not under guardianship. Next, the person appointed guardian by the father. Next, the eldest brother. Then the grandfather. Then the paternal uncle. And then the paternal nephew. He who is the wisest among all of them precedes the others. As for one who is mentally defective and has a good son, his son has the right, more than any of those already mentioned, to be appointed guardian over his father. And after all these come the father, by dwelling who is the tutor. If none of the persons mentioned above is available, the judge shall appoint as guardian someone who is trustworthy and capable, after he has tested him. He who is appointed guardian may not sell anything without the consent of the other person who is appointed under him. He must sell at the current price, and dare not carry on trade with the property of the ward, or sell on credit unless it be upon pledge and guarantee. He shall not lend anything of the ward's property, but if he wishes to go on a journey, he must of necessity leave the property in deposit. However, to lend something to a rich man upon guarantee or upon pledge is better than giving it in deposit, if the borrower and the depositee agree. A deposit is given to the custody of the depositee upon trust in him. A borrower has a guarantor for any unforeseen eventuality, while the one to whom deposit is given for custody does not. If a dispute arises between the ward and the guardian's word shall be accepted unless the ward produces a reliable witness. If the ward's benefit or that, if the person appointed guardian states that he used the property entrusted to him for the ward's benefit or that it was lost while in his hands, but not through negligence, his word shall be accepted. But if he says that he gave the ward money after the ward was released from his guardianship, his statement shall not be accepted unless he produces a reliable witness. A guardian must spend for his ward as do others whose life is comparable to that of his ward, and in proportion to his ward's substance, A guardian must not deprive his ward of the necessities of life, such as food, dress, dwelling, and for young persons, marriage in due time and training in a manual or scientific profession. Similarly, if the ward is poor, the guardian shall spend according to his means, as he would for his son, nephew, wife, brother, or servants. The magistrate must appoint an administrator for one who has contracted a loan. The latter may not dispose of the property which is under administration except for things necessary for life. It is evident that the duration of the administration is until such time as he repays what he borrowed. If the borrower admits having contracted a loan with another while his property was under administration, there shall be no payment of the second debt during the period of administration, but the second creditor shall be paid after the borrower pays the debt for which he was under administration. Guardianship is removed when sufficient reasons for removal are shown, as when the ward, having become mature, wise, and free, asks the judge to remove the guardianship from him, and the people bear witness that he is capable of administering his affairs and property. Guardianship must be constituted before witnesses in order to avoid lawsuits involving the position of the guardian. The provisions regarding the duration of the guardianship shall be written down. Similarly, witnesses must be produced for its removal, and the causes for removal must be shown publicly to the magistrate so that he may annul their agreement, and an order must be written to fix the time for removal of the guardianship. If a dispute regarding the ward's property arises between the tutor and the guardian, one must adjudicate between them to see whether the guardian has maladministered, or rather the tutor has spent more than was consumed with the knowledge of the guardian. If something was lost without malice, no one is liable, but if the tutor has maladministered the ward's property, the guardian must sue him for what he has done. If possible, the tutor must provide for himself. If he cannot, he shall be provided with the necessities of life from the property of the ward until the ward becomes a young man. And these necessities, food, dress, and dwelling, are forthcoming until the ward reaches the age of marriage and learns a trade. One ought to provide properly for a good tutor, since he perfects the ward's will, as if he were the good ward's father, mother, brother, or servant. A good tutor must be wise and must guard the ward's property, but he is not entitled to dispose of or to administer the known property without the guardian appointed over it. The tutor must manage the house after the ward has grown up and acquired other known property. During his lifetime, the tutor shall do only what is necessary and sufficient for life. The guardian shall not lend anything without the knowledge of the tutor. If both the guardian and the tutor give something out on loan, they must recover it in due time. They must not wait until the ward attains maturity and reason, for it is not advantageous for the ward to claim his property if his guardian is not there to testify about the properties over which he was appointed administrator before witnesses and in the presence of the tutor. As is stated above, the tutor shall not go far from the ward during his lifetime. When the tutor is removed, witnesses must be produced and the judge must be given notice of the removal so that it may be confirmed, and the tutor shall command in everything until the ward attains majority. In the canons of the kings it is written, "It is proper that Christians, in order to please God, be pious towards their parents, grandparents, paternal uncles, paternal aunts, maternal uncles, and maternal aunts, and if any of them is afflicted by sickness or by scarcity of intelligence, or if misery befalls him, they must take over his duties, be they important or small. The same help must they also devote to their women, servants, and friends. And this is as it should be, because it is the apostle who said, 'The one who has relatives and does not care to benefit them has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever.'" Chapter 33, Sale, Purchase, and Related Matters. This chapter is divided into 7 sections taken from Aptilus, from the Canons of the Kings, and what has been added to these. Section 1. A purchase is not valid unless the seller and buyer may dispose of their own property, unless they make an agreement with knowledge and are not subject to guardianship. A contract of purchase and sale is completed only by the act of giving on the part of the seller who owns the object and of receiving on the part of the buyer without violence. They shall not complete their contract unless another person acceptable to both is present, even if this person has not made the estimate. And if one of them agrees to the proposed terms of the contract, the consent of the other shall conclude it. If he agrees, he shall perform the contract. If not, let the proposed terms be destroyed. Neither the giving of an object on the part of the seller nor the receiving of it on the part of the buyer shall take place if they part before reaching an agreement on the price. For the conclusion of a contract of sale depends on the consent of both seller and buyer. In the sale of objects which are not present, a contract made in reliance on another's testimony is of no effect, nor is the consent given therein. But if the quality of the object is known, the sale is consummated. If not, the buyer must either give his consent by saying yes or refuse, making the proposal of no effect. The buyer takes possession of a movable object, whether he takes the object he bought with him, or the seller promises to send it after him, as in the case of beast, slaves, edible and potable objects, clothing, timber, valuable metals, objects which pass from hand to hand like pearls, objects made by goldsmiths, and similar items of jewelry. Regarding immovables, such as fields, gardens, and lands, the purchaser must declare that he knows them well. Some contracts of sale and purchase are made in writing, and some without writing. A written contract in the possession of the buyer is valid if the document was attested by 2, 3, or more witnesses, and written by one of the witnesses, the seller, or a scribe who has been given the price for writing. The contract should specify the agreement on the sale and other related terms, the object for sale, the amount of the price, whether the price is to be paid immediately, and the date of payment if it is on credit. A contract made without writing may be concluded either with or without payment of earnest. The receiving of earnest by the seller from the hand of the buyer brings about the conclusion of a contract of sale and purchase. If the buyer rescinds the sale, the seller keeps the earnest. If the seller rescinds, he must pay double the earnest he received. That is, he shall repay twice the amount he received. If an object to be sold for cash passes from the seller's hand to the buyer's, the contract is concluded. The consummation of the sale is the receiving of the object by the buyer and the payment of the price to the seller. If the sale is on credit, that is, if the contract of sale is not yet consummated, the buyer shall not dissipate the object until the will of the seller is satisfied and their agreement is fulfilled. That is, until the contract they concluded with full consent has been performed. Changing the type of value of coins agreed upon is not allowed. However, the value of having a particular type of coin is not the same as the value of having a particular value in coin. One must first know the coin to be used in order to ascertain its type and weight. If he is to pay with gold dinars, he shall say 20 large or small dinars, Egyptian or Tyrus dinars, as the case may be. When dealing with silver coins, he shall say unalloyed or mixed, written in Nazareth, as is said in the Holy Book. If they disagree on the question of rate of exchange, the price used by the country's money changers, especially if testified to by the inhabitants of the country, shall prevail. But if the value of the silver they have is not equal to that used in the country, or if the silver is of a different type, the sale and purchase shall not be performed until the value of the silver is ascertained. The seller must be precise and specify whether he is willing to sell both the land and its fruits, or the land without its fruits, or its fruits only, so also for the trees. If the terms of the contract entitle the buyer to an enclosed plot of land, but say nothing about the trees therein, let the buyer enter the enclosure and build the house, and let this and similar things be as is usual among the people. But the parties must know the object which is the subject of the contract of sale. If a plant with unripe fruits is sold, the buyer shall not be obliged to transplant it to his land, nor shall he be prevented from watering it. The party's agreement to leave it and water it there, or to transfer it, is valid. Anything that can be measured by capacity of length, or that can be weighed with a balance, must be sold or bought openly, because what can be weighed and what can be measured by cubit or capacity is preferable. If one buys a piece of cloth for 1 dirham per cubit, he may buy the entire piece, or as much he wishes, at the rate of 1 dirham per cubit. If what he buys is 100 cubits, he shall pay 100 darahim. If the piece measures less than 100 cubits, he may do either of the following. If he wishes, and the seller agrees, he may buy it all at the rate of 1 dirham per cubit. Otherwise, he may annul the contract. If the piece is more than 100 cubits long, their wish shall govern the part exceeding 100 cubits. If one sees something which belongs to him being sold by others and keeps quiet, despite the fact that he could prevent them, it is as if he sold it himself. The slave may buy anything, but all that he buys must go to his master. Section 2. If the thing for sale is spoiled before the sale is completed, one must consider whether the object was in the hands of the buyer or not. If it is the buyer who has spoiled the object, he must keep it and pay to the seller the price agreed upon. But if another has spoiled the object, he shall pay on the buyer's behalf, and the buyer may either cancel the contract or keep it in effect. If the buyer cancels the contract, the seller may claim its price from the person who spoiled the object. If the object sold is destroyed in whole or in part after the sale is perfected, it belongs to the buyer and he must give the seller its price. If a seller has cloth which he sells, and someone buys the cloth and then dyes it, makes a shirt from it, or sews it, the seller is not responsible for any defect in it if the buyer wants to give it back. And all similar cases merit the same judgment. If the buyer was aware of a previous defect in the object and could have sued the seller for this defect but failed to do so, his right to bring an action is cut off. The first buyer is not liable if, unaware of any defect, he bought a slave and later sold him to another person who discovered the defect and sued him for it. But he must procure reliable witnesses who testify that he was ignorant of the defect, for his statement alone is not sufficient. The second buyer has an action against the first seller. If someone makes a contract with another concerning anything, but acts without the intervention of a judge, he incurs no debt. Any object whose defect was apparent at the time of sale entails no debt for that defect, whether the seller has specified all the defects in detail or not. Section 4. Things which may not be bought and sold. The sale of free persons, of Christians to infidels, of relatives, or of salaried servants is absolutely forbidden, nor is it allowed to sell a charitable legacy, or, in particular, a slave not owned previously. No one shall sell a deposit entrusted to his custody, or anything which cannot be delivered to the buyer, such as a fugitive slave, a fish in the river, a free bird, or an antelope wandering in the desert. Never shall people buy or sell a servant who flees, nor the fisherman, fish which are still in the sea, nor the fowler, free-flying birds, nor the hunter, the antelope of the desert. One shall not purchase or exchange forbidden things, such as dead animals, blood, meat half eaten by animals, things slain as a sacrifice to idols, mortally poisonous animals, rapacious animals which are not fit for hunting and offer nothing but harm, such as snakes and lions, and deadly plants and other things which cause death. Unless things such as reptiles and objects whose price cannot be known at the time of bargaining, bearing in mind the time between the day of sale and that on which the price is given, shall not be sold. Nor should one sell something the appearance of which is not known, such as the unborn fetus without his mother, fruit before it buds appears, milk which is still in the breast, musk in a bottle, or honey in a vase. Things owned jointly by many people, streets, grasses growing in a public pasture, or water flowing through public domain, shall not be sold unless the latter are removed from their place. From their places, one must not sell a pregnant slave without including her unborn child, nor a mother who still nurses her baby without the child, lest he perish. One must neither buy for a slave one who must be condemned to death, nor give weapons to plunderers, such as a knife to a thief, a sledgehammer to a robber, or a golden seal to an unauthorized person. No one may sell a prohibited object together with an object which may be sold, as, for instance, selling two persons as slaves, although in fact one of them is a free man. The buyer may choose to keep the person who was in fact a slave, but the seller must return to the buyer the price of the one who could not be sold. The one who buys something in order to give it as a legacy or as alms must give it away as soon as he can, either by making the legacy or by giving it as alms, unless he unexpectedly loses his wealth and becomes poor. If someone sells a piece of land he does not own, and the buyer builds a house on it, the rightful owner may collect its price either from the fraudulent seller or from the buyer, or, if he wishes, he may take for himself what is built on the land, estimating the price the land would have fetched before the building on it, and paying the value added after the building on it. And the buyer may choose either to agree to this or to remove the new thing he has built. He may reclaim the price he paid from the fraudulent seller. However, the law is that no one may buy from thieves. A testamentary executor must not buy anything from the property of the orphans. The same rule applies to a mandatory. A public official is permitted to buy neither movable nor immovable property from his superior or from his subordinate, whether directly or through an intermediary, unless he pays the established price and the seller consents to the sale. If someone acts contrary to this rule, let him be deprived of what he bought, foretelling also what he paid. The whole shall be put aside for charitable use. One shall not take possession of objects bought on an invalid condition, for example, where a man has said, "When this cow gets a calf, and its calf begets another calf, I will sell you the calf which will be born to it, or I can sell you this land for 50 dinars, provided that you sell me your slave for 20, or I can sell you this slave for 10 dinars if you pay immediately, or for 20 on credit." Section 5. What is to be abstained from, and what constitutes improper practice in selling and buying. Whatever causes harm to others is bad, such as separating a woman slave from her child, especially before he attains the required age, or separating a slave from his brother, or separating a slave from his wife and child. Similarly, it is forbidden to sell a slave accustomed to the usages of a country to a foreigner. Unless the slave gives his consent, it is forbidden to say to someone who bought from another on condition of trial, "Cancel the contract you have made with A, and I will set it to you at a cheaper price, or at the same price he offered to you, and my goods are better than his." It is also forbidden to say to a man who is going out to sell something he owns for profit, "Do not sell it, for I will sell it for you, little by little, at a higher price." Nor must one buy anything on Sundays, on the Lord's feast, and on the feast of Our Lady, Mary. But if the contract has already been made, the purchase is valid. If a buyer finding a new roll of woolen cloth is bargaining with the seller about its price, it is improper for him to bring another buyer who offers to buy it at a price lower than what is normally charged at the place of sale, or to buy it at the price. When the seller discovers this, he may disregard the offer he made to the second buyer and cancel the sale. If someone buys something for 10 dinars and sells it to another through his partner, servant, or friend for 20 dinars or less, the second buyer must be told of the addition to the price. He may obtain back the amount in excess of his seller's cost, or, if he prefers, may buy the goods at the price originally charged him. In any event, the sellers must make known to him the price they fixed by fraud. Whatever involves fraud in sale is bad, and it is forbidden to estimate price unjustly, to forbid what is permitted, or to obstruct the purchase of basic necessities like food, drink, clothing, or shelter, so as to greatly increase their price. Section 6. The contract which has been consented to is binding. It is improper to reduce or increase the price in violation of the contract. If a defect is found in the object for sale, it may be sold at a lower price than agreed to originally, as if there were a different contract of purchase. If a part of the object for sale is missing, the rest may be bought at a lower price by deducting the proportionate price of the missing part. The contract is annulled if the object is completely destroyed, but if it is destroyed only partially, the contract is still in force for the remaining part. If gold or silver is found in a house which has been sold, hidden from its former owner at the spot where it was first buried, it shall be given back to the original owner. Section 7. Assignment of debt. An assignment of debt is not valid without the consent of the assignor and the debtor, but the consent of the assignee is not necessary. If an assignment is made without the consent of the debtor, it will result in a dispute between the assignee and the debtor, since an assignment is only good if it is made for the amount assigned with agreement and goodwill. The assignor shall not force the debtor to give his consent if the latter has no money. If the assignor and the debtor agree, the assignment is made with the consent of the latter in proportion to the amount he has or agrees to give. It shall be part of the agreement whether he shall pay the debt immediately or after a definite period of time. Such an assignment is certainly valid. If the assignment is properly made, all the assignor's obligations devolve upon the debtor. If a seller assigns his accounts so that money passes directly from a buyer to the seller's assignee, and if then the buyer returns the goods he bought to the seller, the money given to the assignee becomes a debt of the seller to the buyer. If the buyer returns a part of what he bought because of some defect, so that he no longer has goods in proportion to the money he gave the assignee, the seller must replace the defective goods. Chapter 34, Partnership, from Aptilus and other paragraphs. A partnership is formed by word, by work, and by service, among all those who are suited for it. A partnership may be formed to do business, to spend, and to deal with affairs that yield profit. It may also be formed by those who are not equal in wealth, since the poor partner, who has no money, can satisfy his needs by watching over the goods carefully, and thus share in the profit. If their partnership is formed by service without specifying what this service consists of, it shall be formed of goods acquired by them as a result of trading, to the exclusion of inheritance, donations, and what is received by will. If there is an agreement between the partners that what they inherit shall be incorporated in the partnership, they shall not bring into it what was left to them by someone's will. If they agreed not to dissolve the partnership until a certain time, the one who causes its dissolution before that time is liable, unless it was for good cause. This is when the other partner does not carry out his obligation under the contract, becomes insane, or dissipates the partnership's money. Any damage caused by the laziness or fraud of one of the partners is his sole responsibility. But stolen goods and unforeseen or necessary expenses which do not concern only one of the partners, as do expenses for children, relatives, or personal debts, concern both partners, just as they share any loss or any profit. The partnership does not extend to goods acquired by the partners outside the partnership. If the contribution made by one of the partners is lost after the establishment of the partnership, the loss is borne not only by him, but by both partners. If the sales price or the higher price is received by one of the partners after he takes delivery of something for trade, it shall be shared by both partners, just as they share loss and profit. The partners shall share the profit or the loss if one of them buys goods on behalf of the partnership using other sources, that is, using his own or his partner's money. If one of the partners repairs a house owned jointly, lest it deteriorate, or repairs it with the agreement of his partner, he shall ask his partner to repay him his share of the cost of repair within 4 months. If the other partner fails to pay within that time, despite his request, let it be done as the repairer chooses. If he prefers, he may pursue his claim. If not, let him take the house after having first informed the judge that he is taking possession of his partner's share in proportion to what is due to him for what he has spent to repair the house. The law gives the possession of the house to the one who built it. The debts of the partnership shall be paid before the partnership is dissolved. As for the immovable goods of the partnership, no partner is allowed to dispose thereof for a purpose different from that of the partnership unless he has the permission of the other partner or, in case of evident necessity, of the judge. Apart from this, partnership must be in all the goods owned by the partners, and all partners shall share in any expenses incurred for manual labor. They shall share any work equally, or one partner may have a larger share in the profits on the basis of the capital and work he contributed. This shall be according to their agreement. Anyone may join the partnership by contributing all of his property or a part of it. A partner may not dispose of the partnership's goods without the other partner, unless the latter allows the former to do so. If there is a provision in the contract that one of the partners shall administer the property of the partnership alone, to the exclusion of a determined part which he may administer only with the consent of the other partners, let it be so. If there is an agreement between two, three, or more partners that one of them is to manage the partnership's property, this may be done. The other partners must not sue him for what he buys or sells, or for what becomes lost or spoiled, nor must they accuse him of fraud, theft, or negligence without reliable witnesses. If one of the partners is dismissed in accordance with the rules of the partnership, the others stay in the partnership until they too are dismissed. If one of the two partners dies, becomes insane, is put under the guardianship of another, or is condemned to death, the partnership shall be dissolved. The partnership is also dissolved if the time for which it was established is over, if the capital on which they agreed is exhausted, if an obstacle to the management of the partnership arises, if the partners want to dissolve the partnership, if one of the partners demands an accounting in private or before a court, or each partner wants to make profit alone using only his share. Chapter 35. Coercion and Duress. To compel a man to deny his faith while he believes in it wholeheartedly is absolutely prohibited, as is said in the chapter on martyrs. The one who endures pain for his faith and is killed is a martyr. If he remains faithful and is spared, he is called a faithful witness. Since he is a witness, his rank is next to that of the martyrs, and his proximity to the rank of martyrs is in proportion to the pain he has borne and his motive in bearing it. If a man is under compulsion to transgress the law or to do something by which he commits evil actions, killing or fornication, he must bear that from which there is no fear of losing his life or of having one of the parts of his body spoiled. One who wants to have the reward he expects must accept violence with patience, bearing the affliction which befalls him, and must be careful not to damn his soul. He must persevere in doing good without letting himself be obstructed. The resistance he offers should be in proportion to the greatness or smallness of the compulsion to sin. The act of compulsion on the part of the compeller and the subsequent transgression of the law are imputable to any person who in turn compelled the compeller. If one is compelled under the threat of death to kill a man, he must not yield to it. Neither must he commit fornication, especially if it is a prohibited union. If a man is compelled against his will to agree, to sell his own property, to buy another's property, to lease his property, to hire another's property, or to confess to another something which is not with him, he may either perform the resulting contract if he wishes, or refuse to perform it if he does not. As for the compulsion to give a guarantee, if the slave he was forced to buy loses something belonging to him, it is the duty of the one who forced him to buy the slave to pay the equivalent value. If the slave flees, the one who exercised the coercion shall bring him back, pay the price of the slave, or replace the slave. If after he has paid the price or replaced the slave, he later brings the slave who fled to the one who was compelled to buy him, then the latter may choose either to return the price he took or to return the slave given as a replacement, or if he deems him more useful, to retake the former slave. The same holds true if the compelled buyer has sold the slave, or if he has given him away to others and he later comes back. If the compeller manumits or gives away as charitable legacy or alms the slave bought compulsorily by another, he must return the price of the slave to the person forced to buy him. If he does not, the one compelled to buy the slave may either charge his price to the account of the compeller and keep reminding him of his debt until he becomes rich, or share with him in his act of charity, thus fulfilling a pious work. Otherwise, he is entitled to half ownership as measured by restitution of the equivalent price. If a person has given a wife to a slave bought under compulsion, or has given him his daughter to be his wife, the payment of the price does not cease to be required, and the compeller must pay the equivalent price. If one has applied duress to the owner of a female slave, so much so that he forcibly buys her from him, and if later he marries her or gives her in marriage to another, the purchase is not annulled, and he must complete the equivalent price. If what he bought by force, whether slave or beast, dies while it was with him, without any fraud or damage on his part, or if it is stolen from him, he has no obligation to pay its price again. If one is forced to manumit his slave, to give him away as a charitable legacy or alms, or to have him married, he may choose. If he wishes, he may forego the price. If not, the one who coerced him must give him the price of the slave. As for the use of duress, if the one who used duress to take something is a rich man, he shall pay 5 or 4 times the value of what he took, as provided in the Mosaic law. The debt must be on his account. However, if he is unable to restore 5 or 4 times the value, but is able to restore double, as provided in Aptilus 39, he must pay double. Failing this, the law provides that the entire object taken, or whatever part of it may be found with the taker, must be taken away from him. If the object taken cannot be found, the one who took it by violence must replace it with a similar object of the same value. As for the value, if the person from whom an object was taken by duress wishes, he may be repaid either in proportion to the value of the object taken had at the time it was taken, or in proportion to the value of the object at the time he is indemnified through a court's decision, should this be possible for him. As provided by law, the one who takes using duress shall provide a guarantor for what he has taken. If the object taken has been modified by the work of the taker, as by building a house on a field, or by making a new fence, or a chair, if the object consisted of timber, it becomes the property of the one who took it, but he must pay the price it bore before the modification. If it is a beast, and the taker has fattened it, or a slave, and he has trained it in a trade, the person from whom it was taken may choose. If he wishes, he may claim the price He may claim the price the object would have fetched before the change which the one who took it brought about. Or, if he wishes to take the object back, he must pay the cost of fattening the beast or training the slave. Thus, there are two solutions: to agree on the object's original price, or to be freed from its improvement. If they do not agree on the price, it shall be fixed according to the word of the person from whom the object was taken, accompanied by his oath, provided that it is not contradicted by reliable testimony. The profit obtained from the object taken, such as rent drawn from it, or the offspring of a beast, shall be taken by the one from whom the object was taken. If the product of the object has perished because of the fault or fraud of the one who took it by duress, he must pay the equivalent price. If it perished without any fault on his part, he is not responsible. If the thing taken by duress was money, alms must be given for the owner's benefit. The one who tears another's clothes shall pay for the reduction of its value. If the cloth was rendered absolutely useless, he must pay the equivalent price. As for the one who takes a white dress by duress and dyes it, the owner of the dress may choose either to take the price of the dress or to take the dress and pay the price of dyeing it. As for a slave, if the master who took him by duress trains him to dye, the slave shall give his master whatever he earns by the work of his hands. And if the new master manumits the slave because of the wealth he has obtained from his labor, gives him away as a charitable legacy or alms, or gives him a wife, there is still no difference between that slave and an object taken by duress in the judgment to be rendered. The person from whom he was taken must have the slave's price, which shall be paid in whole by the taker. Should the one who took the slave be completely unable to pay, as when he has manumitted the slave, or can make a partial payment only, let the owner take whatever is available. And it is proper for the one who takes by duress to pay the full price in proportion to what he earns. If it is an object which he has altered or given as alms, and its price or half of its price is not found with him, the one from whom it was taken may either make note of the taker's name in his account book, and suspend the date of payment until he becomes wealthy enough to pay, sharing with him in the object until expiration of the term, or give him the object as alms, or if he wishes, take the object back. The purchase is not annulled, and the one who takes by duress must pay the price, even if he has had the slave married, or if he himself has married the female slave. If he does not have the price at hand, it shall be fixed by judgment according to what he earns. Chapter 36. Lease and Lessor. One hires something in order to draw benefit from it by paying a price. A lease is a contract made verbally for the drawing of benefit upon compensation. Whatever constitutes the price in purchase serves equally well to pay the rent in letting, as long as the letting is for a profit, not prohibited by law. A lease between parties who are entitled to enter a contract of sale is not valid without the consent of the lessee and lessor, and must be for drawing reciprocal benefit. A lessor must know two things about what he hands over to the lessee: the benefit he will derive, and, if the lease is for a limited time, the duration of the lease. For example, where a house is leased for dwelling, it is necessary to ascertain the duration of the lease. Where a beast is leased for riding, it is necessary to know the route. If the lease is for work, as in the case of hiring a man to sew a dress, or a beast to transport something, these matters shall be according to the agreement of the parties. An example of what may be leased without determining duration is an Egyptian farmland. It is known that the contract comes into effect when the river Nile floods the land, irrigates it, and then recedes during the sowing. Regarding what is required in the lease, the lessor must do for the lessee whatever is necessary for the latter to draw benefit from what is leased, as by showing him the field, by removing obstacles that hinder enjoyment of the thing leased and the making of profit, or by providing him with the necessary beast. But the implements which the lessee takes for his advantage, such as a pail and the rope on it, must be returned at the end of the lease. One may not hire forbidden things such as mourners and sorcerers, nor may one lease dinars or silver coins, for such practices encourage usury. It must be specified whether an object is leased in whole or in part. As for paying the tailor, the one who cleans clothes, the baker, the baker, and other in that category, they may claim their wages only after they have completed the work. The owner of a house, after having contracted to lease it, may ask for the rent daily, whether the lessees dwell in it or not, unless according to their agreement and knowledge, it was clear that he would collect the rent monthly. Craftsmen, such as dyers and silversmiths, may keep the object they took or made from its owner until they receive their wages. If an object is lost, but not by his negligence or fraud, the craftsman incurs no debt, but shall lose his wage. The lessee incurs no debt if he hires an object which becomes spoiled while in his custody, provided that there was no negligence or fraud on his part and that he observed the terms of the contract. The lessee incurs a debt if there was an agreement not to light a fire in the house, but he did light one. Before beginning the construction of a house, the builder shall have the employer's guarantee that the latter will supply him with the grass and timber required for the job. If a boatman overloads the boat against the advice of his companions, or at an improper time, or overloads a boat in poor condition, he is liable. But if he was not negligent, he incurs no debt. If a man takes a stone to carry it or to split it, and he breaks it for want of skill on his part, he shall either pay or not. A washerman is liable if rats spoil any of the clothes given to him because he was negligent in not looking after them properly. Similarly, a person is negligent if he is given something on lease and fails to keep it safe. He is liable if he failed to defend it when he could have done so. One who leases something with the knowledge that the lessee will be exposed to some harm and does not warn him of it is responsible for any harm done to the lessee if the latter was not aware of the possible danger, as in the case of a cracked vessel or a grassy pasture or water which causes harm to the animals that graze on it. And the one who receives wages for keeping something is responsible if he is careless in keeping it. One may lease a house even if what will be done in it is not known. However, nothing unusual shall be done in it, nor anything which may spoil it, unless there is an express agreement to do such a thing, such as building a stream, bath, or a kitchen. A lease of farmland shall be in accordance with the usage prevalent in similar things. If the one who sows does not manifest his intention to renew the lease, the lessor may ask him to remove any construction he built on the land and anything he planted when the lease expires. On the other hand, they may agree to leave the construction and what has been planted intact, so that the tenant may keep them and the landlord may keep the land. Or, again, they may agree on the purchase of the land by the tenant, or on the renewal of the lease for the land, or on giving the equivalent price of the land's rent if the rent is measured in crops and the tenant has sold them, or on leasing another house with its plantings. The lessor may sell to the lessee what he had leased to him. If he does, the rent fixed in the lease before the purchase shall no longer be paid, and they shall agree to terminate the lease upon purchase of the land. If the lessee's situation is altered by sale of the leased property to a buyer, let the rent be determined according to the previous choice of the lessee. A buyer who is not aware of the lease may choose either to purchase the land or to cancel his purchase when he learns of the lease. Beasts may be hired for riding or transportation in accordance with custom. The wage for riding shall be equal to that for transportation. If the hirer has not explicitly stated who will ride the beast or what he will load it with, he is not allowed to change the weight of the load the load or its type unless he reduces the load. For example, one who hires a beast in order to load it with a mechlit of cotton may not load it with a mechlit of iron, nor may he load it in excess of the established measure. He must conform to the measure established by the agreement. Whosoever hired a beast for traveling over a determined route and then went beyond it is responsible for any harm done to the beast, unless the owner was aware of the change and did not object to it. And if part of what was agreed upon, such as victuals or the like, is not included in the beast's load, the hirer may take other goods equivalent to the missing part and the load and load the beast with them unless he and the lessor agreed otherwise. Causes for termination of a lease. A lease terminates when the time agreed upon expires and the obligation to pay rent correspondingly ceases. The lease may also be terminated if the rent decreases in value. Whosoever hires a house and finds a defect in it that may make it harmful to dwell in may terminate his lease. And if such a defect appears in the house, he may terminate the lease the moment that dangerous defects appear in it. The same holds true for other benefits. If either the lessor or the lessee dies, and if the contract was made with the other only, the contract is terminated. The mason must receive his wages after he completes a building. If he does not, he may ask the employer to produce a guarantor. He is entitled to sell the wages he receives for his labor all the days of his life. The provisions apply to both seller and buyer. If a laborer sells wages he received for work he has not performed, the buyer is responsible if he was aware of this. But if the buyer was unaware, he is not liable for what he has bought, whether it is a mule, a sheep, or a similar beast, or any other object. But the bargain between the seller and the buyer must be made in the presence of experienced witnesses. If the wages paid to a laborer are found to be inadequate after he has toiled for many days, and this is because a defect which should not be there is discovered in the work he has done, the laborer must receive for his work wages determined in the measure of the work done, in proportion to an estimate of its value. But a full wage is due if the work was committed to the worker and executed by him according to the model he was given. Furthermore, if a man's wages are inadequate because the house he built does not yield the expected rent, and defects which do not make it uninhabitable are found therein, let his wages be inadequate. If defects are found in the house, one must not say that the wages are inadequate. The same holds true for other benefits. The contract shall be terminated if either the lessor or the lessee dies and the contract was made with the other only. If a person hires a house for one dinar per month and does not fix the number of months of the lease, he may terminate the lease after 1 month. One may reserve an option for a fixed period of time in the contract of lease and terminate the contract within that time. If the object hired is stolen or something occurs which hinders enjoyment of it, the lessee may terminate the contract and pay only for the period before termination, unless the object is returned to him in its original state. A lease may be terminated for justifiable cause, but the termination is valid only for the unexpired term of the lease, and not for the term before termination. When such termination occurs, both the lessor and the lessee are deprived of their respective advantages, independent of their will in that matter. As for the leases which may be terminated before the stipulated time, the cases are the following. If one leases a field for a definite period of time and the field is attached while the lease is still in force, the owner may pay his debt with the field. If he has no other means of paying his debt but the price of the field. If one sets free a slave, he leased or gives him away as a charitable legacy or as alms, having the good will to do this regarding his slaves. The one who hired the slave must return him. If someone flees from the work he was hired to do or from employment to carry heavy objects, the person who employed him may claim him, and when he finds him, sell his beast by order of the judge. to pay for the service the employee failed to perform, or to repay the loan he contracted in the presence of the witnesses to meet the debt the employee had caused by his failure to give his services. The lessee may terminate the contract in any of the following cases: if he rents a house but goes on a journey, if he hires a beast to go on a journey but does not go, if he leases a house to do business in it but his merchandise perishes, if a baby dies after a woman was hired to breastfeed it, if the baby refuses to take the woman's milk, or if the woman refuses to feed the baby. This section deals with a number of details. The lessee must pay the lessor the amount agreed upon. Once they agree upon increasing or reducing the rent, neither of them shall refuse to honor the agreement. If a person has a tenant who pays rent with edible objects, and the latter consumes them because of famine, and then the next year is a year of abundance, the tenant shall replace what he consumed, since the owner will return to take what is due to him. But if famine strikes the second year as well, the owner shall renounce that year also. The one who stands as tenant for any property has no obligation to pay rent if, by God's wrath, some event spoiling the fruits occurs to them, but he has an obligation to pay if the damage done is moderate. The tenant who must pay his landlord as a partner is obliged to pay from the goods of the partnership to the extent of the profit or the loss. If the tenant leaves the field he leased without good cause before the expiration of the contract, he nonetheless remains its tenant until the termination of the contract. If there is an agreement to appoint an overseer, we recommend that a good man suitable for this be appointed. If people take certain premises on lease and disappear for many years or neglect the upkeep of the place, such as putting on a roof and similar things, the one to whom this has happened may call the elders and show them what has happened there. Then he may do what he likes. If a place is rocked by an earthquake, the cost of any damage done to it is to be borne by the landlord. A lease may last until the end of the lessee's life, or until the period of time agreed upon by the contracting parties has expired. This period of time shall not exceed 30 years. Governors and members of their entourage are not permitted to take anything on lease or as pledge, whether for their own use or for the use of others who commit a fraud by such an act, unless they make the lease upon payment of the equivalent price. If they fail to pay the fair price, the price shall be taken from their hands and paid to the lessor from the beginning to the end. A person who took a large estate on lease shall not himself pay tribute for it. Rather, he may sell part of the rent to pay it, after informing the magistrate of the terms of sale in the presence of the bishops, the deacons, and the priest, who shall put the divine gospel before them. If there is no other way of collecting the tribute, the rent may be sold by the owner, who shall pay the tribute out of the proceeds of the sale. All this to be done in the presence of witnesses. Chapter 37. On streets, squares, paths, repair of buildings, and the flow of water to fields and rivers in the countryside, as found in the Abtevis. Provisions on jointly owned buildings. No one of the joint owners of a building may put servants therein without the consent of his partners. As for a wall owned jointly, no one may demolish it or build it without the consent of his partners. No one may build an oven or a fireplace for a bath near a wall owned in common in such a way that the fire damages the wall. If someone builds an oven from which smoke rises, thereby injuring those who dwell in the upper story, the law commands that he be forbidden to direct the smoke towards them, unless he has a right to direct it there. Similarly, those who dwell upstairs may not drop water or throw dirt, which may harm those who dwell downstairs. They may not do so because they may carry out in their dwelling only those activities that do not harm their neighbors. The same rule applies to wells. One is permitted to build a staircase on the side of a certain wall, provided that it does not harm another. As for the wall which is in a deserted place, no one shall be prevented from making it higher. Nor is it good for one to prevent his neighbor from building a door leading to an internal path if there is no danger of injury to passers-by. Provisions on the distance between buildings and trees. If a man wishes to build a fence, he must keep it one step away from his neighbor. If it is a house, it must be at a distance of 6 steps. If it is a pit or a hole, the distance shall be in proportion to its depth, but if it is a well, the distance shall be 5 cubits, provided that his neighbor does not have a well already. If his neighbor has a well, he shall not dig a well. If he wants to plant an olive tree or a fig tree, he shall take 9 steps from the plants of his neighbor, and then he may plant it. But if he wishes to plant anything else, the distance shall be 5 steps. If in the middle of one's enclosure there is a tree whose roots extend to the foundation of his neighbor's enclosure, thereby damaging it, the magistrate must order the tree cut. If 2 houses are side by side, the distance as measured between their foundations and their tops shall be 12 feet. If someone makes his building higher, others may raise theirs as high as the top of that building, put in new windows, and renew old ones. And if a man demands from his neighbor the distance of 12 feet, he may not obstruct his neighbor's view, provided that the latter's house gives on the view from a place which has the right to it. However, he must look towards this view standing up without turning or sitting down without straining his head to see. If there is a distance of 100 feet between the 2 houses, whosoever wishes to obstruct his neighbor's view may do so. As for one who builds a house, if there is a square or a large flat of land between him and his neighbor, and if the measure of the square and the flat of land is a distance of 12 feet, neither of them shall include this space within his house. But if it is a larger than this, they will not be crowded together, and each of them may observe his rule. If there are 2 houses which stand 12 feet apart, the form of the space between them shall not be changed, and neither owner may either make his house higher or build windows. If there is 10 feet between 2 houses and nothing more than this, the owner of the second shall not put in windows to look through, if he did not have them before, but may build the windows to let in the light. Repair of buildings and servitude. He who rebuilds a fallen house and wishes to build higher, or to deprive his neighbor of light, must abide by the limits of his former house, not exceeding them. And he who owns a house with respect to which there is a right to build higher, has the right to make it higher as he wishes, in such a way, however, that if his neighbor's house is built under his, it does not collapse. The right to build higher must be tempered by an attitude of mercy towards all the houses if they do not have windows on any side. If you do not have the right to make your house higher, lest it block the light which comes in through the window in my wall, and later on I close my wall and windows, this my right to have light becomes yours. Or, if I have kept it closed for 10 years, I lose my right from the moment you put up your house at a later time. But if you did not undertake to build anything new, the right remains in my favor as it was formerly. If I reopen the windows after 10 or 20 years, and if you want to build a house, I may keep you out of the place to which my right extends. If you have given up the right in my favor, allowing me to put my beams on your house, and the beams are too heavy for your wall, whereupon I leave this place, take away my hut, and build another house, and then 10 years pass without my putting my beams back in their original place, or if you build a house there after I have removed my hut and closed its windows, and then 10 years lapse, you are in your full right. But if you have built nothing there, nothing new there, but have left it as it was, the right remains perpetually in my favor. If after 20 years I wish to put my beams back in the wall, erecting them in their former place, no one may hinder me from doing so. As for fixing the time limit of servitudes, people shall not make agreements that have an extremely long duration. They shall be limited to 30 years. No one may throw dirt on a wall not belonging to him unless he has a right to do so. Similarly, one may not cause smoke from an oven or bath to rise to the damage of another. The same holds true for other forms of servitude. If there is need to repair a sewer, the dispute which might arise between the co-users on account of the repair shall be settled by requiring that everyone repair it for the distance beginning at his place and continuing to his neighbor's place. If one of the partners has incurred expenses on account of the common property and the other has agreed to pay his share, he may claim from his partner the amount specified as the latter's share until such time as he recoups the amount he spent from his own funds. If your fence leans against my house, I must give you the half foot necessary to restore it. He who builds a window in a fence he does not own must pay for using it until he restores the fence to its original condition. Waters. People in the lowlands have a right to demand that their counterparts in the highlands let the waters flow properly. The former must compensate the latter for this advantage, since they take the wealth and the fertility of the highlands inhabitants' land. As for the right to use water, it shall be extinguished on the expiration of the time fixed. Whether it was originally to be exercised for the duration of the summer, only a month, more than a month, or for more than a year, by the same token, the use of a waterway ceases after expiration of the fixed period of time, until the time comes again, be it for a day, an hour, or for a day and night continuously. If one is entitled to bring water from a spring which dries up, a long time, but later flows again, the right is reestablished in his favor, and he may bring the water from that place again. And if someone gives you the right to water animals at his pool, he must provide you with a road by which to water them. If you cannot use another road, whosoever has the right to water or to graze his cattle on your land has another right, namely, to build a hut there. Whosoever has a water reservoir on the land of another must have a road by which he may go to his property and a place where he can put earth, stones, tools, and whatever is necessary for irrigation. If there is a river flowing between my land and yours, and little by little it washes away a part of your land and adds to mine, without your knowledge or without you having seen how much it took away and on what day of the river's flowing this happened, and if the river flowing between us two washes away a part of your land and adds to mine, this added part remains yours. Purchase of buildings. Anyone who buys and takes possession of a piece of land, and then, well aware that the land did not belong to the seller, puts buildings on it, may not claim his expenses in building, but may be permitted to remove the buildings from the land. Nothing may be claimed from the true owner. If a powerful man buys land which is not owned by the seller, and sows and builds there, the judge shall not give his decision without examining whether the true owner of the land is entitled to have the building. The one who had the right to build a house there must pay the expenses for the construction of the building, and may then take back the land and what was added to it. If he is so poor that he could not choose whether or not to do what was done, the buyer who in good faith put up the building may remove his building. But if the owner of the land wants to buy the building, the one who built it in good faith shall make it easy for the former to pay the amount he spent for the construction, according to an agreement made between them, and to take the building. If the owner of a piece of land had shown his intention to sell it, he may not retake the land by force, even if he is poor. He shall accept from the builder its fair price after its improvement. All expenses incurred in the improvement shall be charged to him. If a man hides a deposit entrusted to him, or sells it, or gives it away, and if a friend of the depositor knows this, but does not inform the person who bought or received it, or if the depositee gives the deposit as pledge, or for another purpose, after a period of 10 years for the one who is present, or a period of 20 years for the one who is absent, until his return from a journey. The right of ownership becomes valid for him who possesses it after 30 years. But if the true owner is unaware of the transfer, the ownership is not validly transferred to the possessor until 30 years later. If the owner makes his ownership known, saying, "It is mine," within 10 or 20 or even 30 years, it still belongs to him. He shall not be deprived of his original land, his fields, or his inheritance, nor hindered from entering his inherited property. Neither shall the buyer refuse to give him what is his. And if a movable stays in one's hand for 30 years, and no one makes any claim for it, in this case the possessor becomes owner. If I sell a part of my land with the stipulation that I may bring water over it, but the period of time established by law elapses before I build the canal, my right is extinguished, since the land is your property. But if I build the canal and bring water over your land, you have no right to prevent me from bringing the water. If a former owner could not prevent the bringing of water over his land, a buyer may not prevent it either, because in buying, he consented to these servitudes. On the measure of a narrow street, extracted from all the canons laid down in this chapter, no one may renew whatever can cause damage to another. Any right not exercised for 10 years in the case of those present, or for 20 years in the case of absent persons, is extinguished, except the right to use a street leading to a cemetery. In this case, the length of time does not extinguish the right. This period of time is extended during the time between the finding of a prisoner and his return home. In the case of the demented or the invalid because of illness, it is extended until their recovery. For the one who has committed a crime, the passage of time does not eliminate the penalty that he deserves. And he who has a right has also the right to all that without which that right cannot be used. No one may spoil a square of a city or its streets, and he who does this must repair it. The distance between one house and another shall be 12 feet at top and bottom. One may not block his neighbor's view unless there is a gap of 100 feet between the two houses. Whoever wishes to build an enclosure shall remove it one step from that of his neighbor. If it is a house, 7 steps, and if it is a pit or a hole, the distance shall be in proportion to its depth. If it is a well, the distance shall be 5 cubits. Between an olive tree and a fig tree, the distance shall be 9 steps, and between other plants, 5 steps. As for the disputes involving boundaries, the judges shall inquire into the land records, into what is manifest, and was a customary. If a main road is ruined by an earthquake, by water flow, or by similar events, it shall be restored to its original condition by the landlord nearby, insofar as it happened on his land. As for a sewer owned jointly, each owner shall repair his part. He who rebuilds an old house shall not exceed its previous limits, nor impede his neighbor from enjoying light or the view, unless he does so by agreement. Part on judgments deduced by reasoning and added to what has been said in the Aptellus. Whosoever put in the street something which caused damage is responsible for what he did, and for the whole debt, if he alone has done the whole. But if the deed is only partly occasioned by him, his responsibility is only partial. If another person forced him to do this thing, he is not responsible. So also, if he is one who was compelled by an evildoer, and acquiesced in what the evildoer wanted, but later desisted, he shall not be held responsible. Similarly, if one puts something on his own estate, he shall not be responsible. If a wall leans towards the street, and its owners is warned and told to demolish it, but for a long time he does not demolish it, although he could have done so, he is liable for whatever perishes by its falling, be they persons or property. If a wall is leaning towards an enclosure, the owner of the enclosure may demand its demolition. If a wall is shared by 3 persons, each one shall be responsible for a third of what it destroys. All these responsibilities exist whenever one refuses to demolish a leaning wall, although he could have demolished it. What comes after that which has already been dealt with in this chapter? If land lies fallow because of lack of water, or because it is flooded, or if no sound of its being worked is heard in the surrounding countryside, or its owner is not known, a man may work on this land and have ownership of it. At the place which has traces of a building's walls, let him build them up and put over them a roof. And where there is no trace of work, let him make an enclosure, and let him make a door. As for the fields, let him plow them and improve the earth, and let him make the water flow through it. Let him dig wells and springs and draw out the hidden treasures. If something cannot be separated from the building which houses it, without rendering that the thing useless for the purpose for which it was meant, as in the case of a bath, oven, mill, or well, and if one of the partners owning it wishes to sell his partnership share or to lease it, the other partner must buy or hire the share belonging to the former. The price for the purchase of hiring shall be that agreed upon with the outsider. And if the partner was aware of the sale or hiring but ignored it, the person living nearest to the property may take it, as may the one who buys it with the intent of giving it away as a charitable legacy for the poor. Those persons who are not mentioned here shall be treated equally. What is due to the partners is in proportion to the share they own, and what is due to the close neighbors shall be in proportion to the need they have. If an owner has made a contract of sale with a person other than that one who has priority, and the latter then makes one of the contracting parties aware of his desire to purchase, of his intention to make a contract on the price of the other matters, or if it was previously agreed that the owner would not sell the object to the other unless the one who had priority consented, then the contract made with the other person is null. The contract with the one who had priority remains valid. If there is conflicting testimony, the allegations of the buyer who has priority shall prevail, if supported by his oath. And if the one who has priority delays his agreement after he is informed of the seller's intention, unless he has a manifest reason, his right of priority is annulled. The same rule applies to a lawsuit, delayed without a manifest reason. If one who has a right of priority dies, his priority is extinguished. It is not extinguished if one of the other partners having priority dies. Chapter 38, on loan. A contract of loan for common profit may be concluded between those persons who have the power to dispose of the money involved. It is not valid unless it involves specific goods, as to which both the weight and the profit to be derived therefrom are fixed, either in dinars or in other currency. It is not proper to stipulate that the profit from one kind of goods goes to one, and the profit from another kind goes to another, lest quarrels ensue. Nor is it suitable to make a contract for the time during which the working partner will not be able to sell. Rather, it must be made for the time during which he can do business. The working partner must collect the profit and pay expenses as if he were a mandatory. He shall not buy at a price higher than the current and the usual one, nor sell a price lower than the current price. Rather, he should sell at the customary sales price. Moreover, he shall not sell anything on credit without surety and a pledge, the holding of which is equivalent to what is sold, nor without a specified price, and he shall not enrich himself by means of the sale or purchase. He shall not take any loan from the original sum he borrowed with which to do business, nor shall he buy with it anything worth more than it. But all this may be done if he has the approval of the money's owner. As for the expenses incurred in going on a journey for the purpose of trading, it shall be as agreed between them. If no agreement regarding expenses was made before, the expenses shall be borne in proportion to the share of each in the profit. If there is no profit, the expenses shall be deducted from the capital. The partner who runs the business as a mandatory is the trusted lord of the money. His word concerning sale, purchase, profit, loss, amount of profit, and capital must be accepted unless there is a reliable witness to nullify it. But what should be done is to put testimony about the amount of the original capital, the allocation of the profit, the subsidiary agreements in written form beforehand. The owner of the money may resign the contract whenever he wishes, as may the working partner if the former can administer his property or appoint another person to run the business. If one of them dies or loses his intelligence, the contract shall be resigned. The goods must be separated according to their type. If one of them wishes to sell some goods before dividing them between themselves, he may do so. If there is a debt attached to the money borrowed, the working partner shall pay it. If the lender contracted a debt in the interest of the business, he must pay the debt before anything else. Chapter 39, Confession of Liability. It is divided into four parts. Part 1. If a man who is free and has attained majority confesses his fault sincerely, he must do penance for it. And if he admits having a money debt, he must pay it. If a person who is under guardianship, whether because he is a minor or because he is mad, confesses to having committed a fault, his confession is not valid, nor is his admission of having taken money valid. In such a case, the accuser must produce witnesses to prove that he has attained majority and has the use of reason. If a person who is under guardianship, for reasons other than these, confesses to something for which corrective punishment is required, his confession is valid. And if one who is under guardianship is mad, his confession concerning a money debt is void because of his madness. If a debtor who cannot pay one debt is obliged to confess another money debt, he must not pay the latter immediately. He is to pay it after he has paid his first debt. As for a slave, his admission concerning a money debt is valid. If he was not authorized by his master to contract a debt, he has an obligation to pay it after his manumission. If he was permitted by his master to do some work, his master must pay the debt. If the work was other than what his master permitted him to do, he shall pay the debt from the profit he made. If he has made no profit, he shall pay it after his manumission. Part 2. The one in whose favor confession is made. If the person in whose favor an admission of debt is made has the use of reason, the one who admits the debt shall not prevent him from having what is his and deny the debt admitted to him. And if he does not have the use of reason, the precept is that he should be given whatever is advantageous for him from the amount of the debt admitted. The one who cannot accept what has been admitted in his favor causes quarrels, as, for example, the unborn child in the womb of a woman does. And an admission to the effect that a person owes an unborn child some property because the child yet to be born is his natural heir, or because it was willed to him, shall be effective if the child is born alive. If one admits owing property to a minor or to an insane person, the property belongs to the latter. The property admittedly owed to a slave belongs to his master. If one admits owing property to a monastery, it shall be given to those who dwell in it. Part 3. The thing which is admitted as owed to someone. A confession to owing an object must not implicate the transfer of an object which the confessor cannot dispose of, not being the owner of the object. If such a confession were permitted, a confession made by a mad person and a confession to an object not owned would be valid. To the contrary, if one is not an owner, his confession is invalid. When indeed one who is not an owner says, "My field, which I own and which is in my hands by length of use, belongs to A," this shall be void because it is not his property. One is not permitted to dispose of another's property as if it were his own. But an agreement may be made that the field be in his hands and that he may dispose of it. Similarly, if one confesses to the manumission of a slave who was in another's hand, his confession is void. Part 4. The formula of confession and its interpretation. The formula of confession is that the one who who admits being a debtor says, I owe A, a tribute, or A, deposit belonging to B, is with me, or I owe C, a debt. If another says he owes me a tribute, or A, deposit belonging to me, is with him, or he owes me a debt, and the other admits it and says, I owe him a tribute, or a deposit belonging to him, is with me, or I owe him a debt, or I admit the debt, but I have given it away as alms, or I admit it, or I do not deny it, or yes, or expressions similar to this, or others in current use, all amount to confessions. And if he said, I will admit it and not deny it, this is an admission for a future admission. If he says, take, or weigh out, or do what must be done, this must not be said in jest. A confession made in jest is not valid. As for the interpretation of a confession, if one admits to owing something the quality of which is not known, or to owing money the amount of which is asked about by the creditor or the depositor, he may declare an amount as little as possible rather than the amount actually due. And if in making a confession one magnifies the amount of his debt, he has added to his debt. The lesser and the greater amounts are in proportion to 10 darahim. If he says darahim in the plural, the least it can be is 3. If he says many, many darahim, the least it can be is 11. And if he says many and many, the least amount is 21 darahim. And if he says, I owe him a tribute or a deposit or a debt, this means that he admits his debt and must pay it. If he says, objects are with me in deposit, or a slave is with me, or crops are stored in my house, or gold, silver, etc. are kept in my coffer, or beasts are in my custody, this is an admission of deposit, loan, or pledge. Anyone who formulated his word of admission together with another, which cancels the first in whole or in part, cancels his admission totally or partially. This is, for instance, the one who says, this land is yours, but I keep it as pledge, or it belongs to you and your children, or it is yours, but I have put the roof higher, or dwell there without being owner, or it is yours on condition that you pay the price. And he who confesses to be one's parent may do so, unless reason or other evidence prove him false, as in the case of the one who says, this is my son, while in fact they are of the same age, or the admitted son has another known father, or the heirs of the one who admits being the father produce reliable testimony to destroy his admission. Chapter 40. On what is found after having been lost, and what flees to public places such as the countryside, streets, markets, baths, shops, and churches. And this is established in the fifth book of the Pentateuch by the word of God, who said, thou shalt bring back to thy brother what is lost, and if he is not near, and thou knowest him not, thou shalt bring it to thy house, and it shall be with thee until thy brother seeks it, and thou returnest it to him. Whether it be a beast, garment, or any lost object, it is not good for thee to neglect them. This chapter is divided into two parts. Part 1, it deals with things which move from place to place. Whoever finds an object, the owner of which is unknown, and which has such trivial value that the owner would not notice the loss, shall give notice of the finding, announcing it for a week both at the place where the object was found and at another place. In case someone who can identify both the owner and the object comes, having no doubt that the identified person is the real owner, the finder shall return the object to him. Otherwise, he may use it. If the object is valuable and many are sorrowful because of its loss, it is good for the finder to take it and keep it for its owner. He shall ascertain its quality and quantity, the state of the object, and where he puts it. He must call people to bear witness for him and mention to them some distinguishing feature of the object, lest he give the devil occasion to seduce him as Apostle Paul said. And then he shall issue news of the finding every week for 7 weeks in the place where he has found the object, if the place is inhabited, then to those who live near that place, and then at public places such as squares and markets. In the process, he shall mention some peculiar characteristic of the object, as by saying, "Who has lost his dirham?" without giving any further details about quantity, weight, or the size of the person which they were found, or "Who has lost some jewelry or dresses?" but he shall not give any details about their color, size, or quality. If there is someone who comes and claims the lost object and remembers most of its characteristics so that there can be no doubt that he is the true owner, the finder shall know him. The finder shall hand him the object back to him before witnesses and in the presence of persons who know him. He shall produce a free member of the faithful as a witness. If within the said period of time the owner does not come to him, the finder may dispose of the object. If a slave happens to find an object, the announcing, the using, and the ownership of the object belongs to his master. If the finder is one under tutelage and guardianship, the object goes to his guardian. It is good to extend the time of waiting for the appearance of the owner. If the object perishes in the finder's hands because of an evident and unavoidable accident, he incurs no liability, but he is liable if there is a reliable witness who testifies that he caused the object to perish. If some companions were with the finder, but he passed beyond them and then took or ordered somebody else to take the object, the other have no share in it. But if one of his companions, either ahead of him or behind him, saw the object simultaneously with him, he is his partner in keeping the object, in announcing its finding during the period of the time fixed above, and in owning it after the said time elapses. If one who is not his companion sees the object at the same time, the finder shall take the object to a judge. After the period of time for claiming, it shall be given back to the finder. If the one who has found the object is not an inhabitant of the country in which the object is found, it shall be deposited with the chief judge and his companion, who may choose either to keep it carefully with remuneration and to announce it, or to take and keep it without remuneration. The remuneration is in proportion to the duration of time, to the care it requires, and to the value of the object. If the object found is a big animal, such as camel, a horse, a mule, or an ass, which is found in a known pasture, it may not be taken. If it is wandering in the town, it shall not be left wandering. If it is possible to take it, shall be returned only in the presence of reliable witnesses, or with the righteous testimony of two or three known persons. But if the found object is a small animal, such as a calf, a colt, a young ass, a young camel, a sheep, a bird, or some similar animal which is found alone, it must not be left to wander if it can be taken. The one who takes it shall choose to maintain it, either at his own expense during its announcing, if the animal is useful to its owner, or at the expense of its owner, who is then liable for debt to be paid from the profit if the animal yields any profit, or from his own account. When the beast is returned to the owner, the finder shall collect from him, if he so wishes, the expenses he incurred and his reward for having kept it and having published the finding. He shall return it to the owner together with any offspring, if, with the approval of the judge, he wishes to sell the animal after a week, he may sell it. But he should wait for the fixed period of time to elapse, after which he may dispose of the price. It is proper for him to buy a legacy for the needy with its price. He shall give first from the price to the afflicted, since the blood they have shed may be washed away by what he has put aside for them. Or he shall give it as alms to the needy. If there is one who is needier, he should be favored. If the thing found is an object which becomes spoiled soon, it must be sold if possible. If it is food, it may be eaten, And if someone comes and ascertains after the period of time for claiming it has elapsed that the lost thing belongs to him, the finder shall give it back to him if it is still with him. If he has sold it, he shall return the price. In case the finder has used it for himself, he must give back the equivalent of the object if he is rich. If he is manifestly poor, he must give back only that which remains, and if nothing of the substance remains, shall not be sued for anything. If he has given it away as a pious work, the owner may choose either to have the merit of the pious deed, or to have the finder return to him either the whole object, a part of it, if it is still available, or its price. The word of the finder is final in every dispute which arises with the owner, unless the owner produces reliable evidence in the dispute. All that which is found is considered as a deposit in the hands of the finder. Part 2. The boy who is lost and then found. Whosoever finds a boy must declare him free, since to be free is a basic right of the children of the faithful. The boy has the right to be free, and this freedom is the original condition for him, unless there are no faithful in the place in which he has been found, and the infidels declare that he is their son. If the faithful are few, they shall be asked. If anything is found together with him, either tied to him or put near him, it shall be deemed that it belongs to him, and the judge shall order an allowance to be made for him from it. An announcement shall be made concerning his being found and whatever was found with him. If nothing is found with him, and the one who has found him is a rich person capable of maintaining him, he must take him and educate him. Otherwise, the judge shall order the administrator of goods for alms to take him, and the latter shall deliver him to one who will educate him, either at his own expense, if he agrees, or at the expense of the administrator, who will pay for the goods given for alms the amount necessary for educating and training in a trade. The same holds true if one finds a Christian slave or an unbeliever who has not declared himself to be the son of an unbeliever, and the one who says, "He is mine," and produces a reliable witness, whosoever he may be, shall be given the child. The one who educates him must take him as his son and teach him the trade which he prefers for his own children, or a trade which appears to him suited to the boy's natural inclination. He shall watch towards what he inclines and what he desires. He shall take the child, knowing the child's faith, and shall do as is proper to his religion. Part which comes after the preceding. As for the one who brings a fugitive back to the one from whom he fled, whether the fugitive is his son or his slave, or one who is under his tutelage, he who receives the fugitive must pay the finder what he spent for the fugitive. The finder may then choose either to leave the compensation in order to do a good work, or to take it from him. The remuneration due to him is measured by the fatigue caused him, the distance between the two places, that is, the place where he found the fugitive and the place to which he took him, and the period of time between the fugitive's loss and his return. And if the fugitive flees from the one who was returning him, the latter is not responsible, but must cause witnesses to bear testimony for him that he took the fugitive to return him to his master. If the fugitive is a slave or a pledge, payment and return of expenses are the obligation of the one who took it as pledge. If one goes on a journey so that his whereabouts and whether he is alive or not are not known, and something belonging to him is found, it shall be brought to the judge. The judge shall appoint a trusted and suitable administrator who will take charge of the administration either voluntarily to do a good work or for compensation. He is to keep the absent person's object, collect what the latter has lent, pay his family's expenses, and pay his debt. And it is proper for him to disclose to witnesses what he has renewed and to keep an account of his administration. When many days have passed since the object was found, a judgment shall be given among those who have rights to it if the owner of the object is not alive. Those who found it may divide and inherit it after the hope of his return is lost. They shall not divide what they have found until he is found, nor shall they inherit or allow others to inherit the object. Chapter 41. The one who makes a will regarding his property. The provisions laid down in this chapter are divided into five sections. The instrument by which one makes a will and the writing of it. The name of the one who makes a will. The name of the one in whose favor the will is made. The property concerning which the will is made. The one who is appointed testamentary executor by the will. Section 1. The will and the way it is drawn up. The instrument by which one makes a will with due counsel is the wish of a man to give as alms after his death that which remains of his property after distribution of what he leaves for inheritance. According to the sayings of the prophets and wise men, it is advisable to do this, since the prophet Isaiah said to King Ezekiah, pursuant to the word of the highest God, make a will to thy sons, for thou shalt die. As for the wise men, many of them have willed away their wealth as alms to the needy, and there are those who have made charitable legacies, giving their property to the needy and the non-needy. As Apostle Paul has said, only a dying person may make a will properly. No use shall be made of a will while its testator is still alive. A will may be made in writing or orally, with or without appointment of the one to whom the will is entrusted. A written will must be made by the writing of a notary, the one to whom it is entrusted, or the testator himself, and must be drawn up before witnesses who are present at that time. The writing of the will must occur in only one writing. Those who are gathered there shall attest it. If possible, they should be 7 or 5 in number. If not, 3 or 2 witnesses will suffice. The testator, in case he himself writes down the will, shall write in it, in his own handwriting, what his will is, the date, and the names of his heirs, and shall say, I hereby appoint A and B as my heirs. If the testator is unable to write for himself, the witnesses shall write the will instead of him, inscribing the names of his heirs. The one who writes the will down and the administrator mentioned therein must attest it, but the one appointed as heir need not. So also the heirs at law shall write on it, saying, we accept what is written here. A will made in the absence of writing shall not be a fraud on the will made by writing. An oral will in favor of a relative is valid because the relationship is equivalent to writing. It is not valid without witnesses and cannot be made except the presence of witnesses. A will may not be written by the heir. The amounts necessary to wrap up the dead body, to pay the grave diggers, to pay for the grave, and to pay the deceased debts or tributes must be deducted from the estate of the testator, and such payments cannot be made from other sources. No one is permitted to claim what is willed before 9 days have elapsed. A will is of no effect if the testator withdraws it by unequivocal words or by fact, for instance, by selling or freeing a slave, or by marrying a woman slave, contrary to the provisions in the will. In particular, a will is of no effect if he has dissipated what was entrusted to him, or if he has spent what was entrusted to him in a manner which deprives its owner of the title of ownership, renders his name despicable, or conceals its owner's identity. A will is also of no effect if the appointed heir declares, while the testator is still alive, that he will not accept the inheritance. If he then takes it after the testator's death, he should be deprived of the inheritance. Similarly, a will is of no effect if the appointed heir dies before the testator. A will may be annulled by a subsequent will, even the first will was made in writing. A person's testamentary disposition regarding his property shall not be valid if another's property is included therein, unless the property is returned to its owner. A will shall be of no effect if the appointed heir was not a Christian before he accepted the inheritance, at the time the will was made or after this time. Similarly, the will is of no effect if the appointed heir schemes to take away the life of the testator with poison or some such thing. A will is void if it provides that the king receive an inheritance from a subject while the rightful heir is another, or if it is not written in a book with the witnesses therein, as said before, or, in addition to this, if it makes no mention of the one appointed as testamentary executor and of what is entrusted to him. Section 2. The Testator. A will made by a minor, by one who is not free, or by one who has not the use of reason and is not wise enough to make a will, as is laid down in the chapter on guardianship, is not valid. The testator must appoint one to take care of the heir if he is not wise and experienced. This appointment must be mentioned in the will. There is no difference between the heir and the servants as long as the heir is a child, while he is their master. He is nonetheless under the tutor and the guardian until the time appointed by his father arrives. A will made by one who is under guardianship, one who has not attained majority, a slave, one of deficient intelligence, or a totally deficient person, shall be of no effect. If the tutor dies when the pupil is without tutor, or if the slave is set free, or if the deficient has acquired the use of reason, or if a person is born blind or rendered such by an accident, all these may make a valid will. One who was born dumb and deaf cannot make a will, but if he was afflicted thus by a sudden accident and can write down his will, it shall be valid. As for the demented, his will is not valid. Also, a slave is not allowed to make a will unless ordered to do so by his master. The one who is old enough to make a will and who wants to make a written will in favor of his children must make them know those whom he appoints as heirs. If he wishes to leave something to his wife, to extraneous persons by a written testamentary disposition, or to set a slave free, he shall make this known to his heirs at law in the presence of witnesses so that they may testify to the fulfillment of his wishes. If he wishes to change his counsel, turning back from it, he may tear the will and make a new one, in which he shall make known his new intentions. He shall do this in the presence of 7 or 5 witnesses, informing them that he has this intention previously, but that he does not wish to abide by it, and wants to make another will. Then he shall make a decisive will. If a testator bequeaths property to one and later on bequeaths it to another without mentioning any annulment of the first decision, the two shall share the property between themselves. Whoever makes a will may make additions to it or remove a provision from it after he has made it by writing in the presence of witnesses so that they may bear witness to it. If the testator does not wish to make the contents of his will known to those who attest to his writing, he shall fold the will until its top is below the writing. Having done this, he shall give it to the witnesses and say to them, "This document is my will." The witnesses shall then attest it together and seal it. If it is obvious that the testator intended to mention other people in his will but did not finish his word, even those mentioned in the will shall not be called to succeed. And if the testator and his brothers own some property jointly, none of them shall be prevented from disposing of his share by will. If a man with 2 wives loves one of them but hates the other, yet both wives have borne him children, and he wants, when he is about to die, to bequeath his property to the children, he shall not favor the son of the beloved wife to the disadvantage of the son of the wife he hates. Section 3. The heir. The heir may not be one of those who have openly deviated from the divine laws and from the faith. One who worships another besides the true God, or one who by his conduct has cut himself off from the behavior of the faithful in order to associate himself with sinners, because the apostle has said, "What communion have the faithful with the unbelievers?" And he ordered the faithful to keep themselves apart from these and similar people, because they have gone over from faith to apostasy and to other vices, which are fornication and similar things. If they do not break with those people, do not abandon their sinful ways, and do not come back to the faith, they shall not be called to share the succession. But after they abandon their sinful ways, they shall not be treated in conformity with what is said in the chapter on succession. A will made for the benefit of all the heirs at law, are, or some of them only, or for the benefit of another person not related to the testator, is valid with respect to that portion of the estate which does not form part of the legitimate inheritance. The heir shall still be called to the succession even if something happens to the will, or if it is unexpectedly taken. Where nothing has happened to the will and no one has come to steal it, if the heir declines to take anything and wants to give his share to some other persons, he may do so. The one who is in prison or in exile may make a will in favor of an heir, hopeful that he may return someday. And if it happens that the heir is put in fetters or exiled after the testator made a written will, the heir may take what was bequeathed to him upon his release or upon his return from exile. If false news arrive of the death of a son who has gone on a journey, so that his father bequeaths his property to another because his son had gone on a journey, while in fact the son is still alive, the inheritance shall go to his son instead of to the one to whom it was bequeathed. One may bequeath something to a pregnant woman, excluding the unborn child, or to the unborn child to the exclusion of the mother. But the will is void for the child unless he is born alive within the time of pregnancy after the will was written in his favor. And if something is bequeathed to a pregnant woman and the unborn child, and she gives birth to twins, they shall share it equally. If one of them is born alive and the other is born dead, everything shall be given to the one born alive. If the testator has made particular mention of and specified a male as heir, no one shall inherit but that male. A will made for the benefit of a slave is valid. If he is free at the time he becomes entitled to have the inheritance is his, otherwise it belongs to his master. Section 4. The thing bequeathed. The word of the will is void if the testator bequeaths what he does not own. There are two ways of allocating the inheritance. The first is one quarter of the estate, and then another quarter, that which stands second from the left and third from the right, and another quarter, that which stands third from the left, go to the heirs at law. The last quarter is at the discretion of the testator, and he may do what he likes with it. This first way is in conformity with the canon in Mac 1. The children of the testator shall inherit according to the testator's wish. He shall give to each of his daughters her fair share of the dowry, and shall divide his property in four portions. If he wishes to give something of his property in alms, this shall be one quarter of it. From this, he shall assign one quarter to his daughters as their dowry. He may do what he likes with the remaining three quarters. His son shall inherit as he wishes, since our law permits him to do as he wishes and provides that the testator's children succeed to three or the four parts of his estate. If the testator wishes to add something for his daughters, he may do so. If he has no children, he may bequeath his property to whom he wishes. This canon contains the two opinions mentioned earlier, and the statement therein must be accepted unless it is clarified. This canon is not advantageous to any person unless interpreted on the footing of the canons of the second opinion. The concept therein is not clear, and the statement found in a single canon must not be given more weight than that found in the other canons, that is. As for the second opinion, the canons referring to it deal with diminishing the portion due to the heirs at law. A man may divide his property in three parts and give the fourth part of his property to the one he loves. He must set aside a quarter of his estate for his heir at law, without adding anything else. He may do what he wishes with the three parts, and he shall give the fourth part of his estate to whomever of his heirs he wishes. This fourth part he may divide among his children who obey him. If a person has made a will regarding his property, and if the fourth part reserved to his heirs at law is not established, or is less than one-fourth of his estate, he shall establish it and make it of proper size using the remaining half and quarter of his estate. The last fourth part may be bequeathed as legacy to non-relatives. If a dispute arises because of this legacy, the matter shall be examined. In all cases, a fourth part of the testator's estate must go to his heirs at law. If one-fourth is not established for the heirs at law, the half as well as the fourth part for the non-relatives shall be destroyed, and an inheritance for the heirs at law, which consists of a fourth part of the whole estate, shall be established with them. Question. May a man bequeath all his property to his wife who bore him no children? And if he has two children mentioned in his will, should he leave something to her, or should he bequeath to her something apart from her dowry? The answer is, a man must write his will and put there the names of the persons he wants to be called to his succession. Our assertion that the second opinion is more advisable is based on eight considerations. First, as both opinions are found in one book and from one council, but the second opinion is more clearly explained in more than one canon, namely, at the beginning, middle, and and end of the book, while the first opinion is found in one canon only, and is the opinion of the author of the book. This is known from the harmony of the words of the second opinion with those found in several places. Second, the interpretation of the wording of the first opinion is not clear, since it gives rise to different concepts, while in the wording of the second opinion, only the concepts of the second opinion is found. One must follow what he understands more clearly. Third, the first opinion is found at the beginning of the book, while the second is found near the beginning of the book, in the middle, and at the end. The later provisions nullify the first. Fourth, it is said in this book that a man may do what he likes with his property, and he is allowed to dispose of half or a quarter of it, and to do what he wishes without any impediment. Fifth, we have already said that a will shall be according to the commandment of God and the practice followed by wise men. God has said, "Make a will to thy children." That is all he said. He has not fixed a portion by saying to leave less or more. And the wise men, when they established that one may lay down his word in a testament, fixed no limit except that the testator should be guided by what he deems appropriate when he makes his will. It is obvious, then, that the advantage offered by the second opinion is greater. Sixth, reason dictates that a wise person be allowed to do what he likes with his property, because he is the master, and there is no one who can prevent him from selling it, bequeathing it, giving it away as alms, or giving it to whomever he likes. In doing this, he may dispose of the half and the quarter of his property. Seventh, more benefit derives by adhering to the second opinion than to the first, because one who adheres to the second opinion may follow and be guided first in his judgment if he sees an advantage in it, while the one who follows the first opinion may not do so if he sees an advantage in the second opinion. Eighth, adherence to the first opinion entails much damage. The second opinion does not, because it is possible that some of the testator's children will be rich and the rest poor, and it is right that the father bequeath more to the poor. It is also possible that his heirs at law will be rich. In such a case, he may leave a charitable legacy or give alms, and thus free many people from poverty and slavery. Finally, the reason for the tendency we mentioned to prefer the first opinion over the second is that the testator who follows the second might be hated by his heirs at law because of supposed injustice in their regard, or because of jealousy on their part, or because he has preferred others over them. Also, by following the second opinion, there is a possibility that the heirs might be prevented from having the greater part of the whole estate. But all this may be done also by the testator who follows the first opinion, since he must do as he sees proper, either by giving what he wishes to the people, other than his heirs, with his hand, or by selling something to them, or by confessing to be indebted to them to the extent he wishes, or by selling something to others so that he may give the proceeds of the sale to the former. But when the matter is settled according to the second opinion, it is well settled. The testator must bequeath a half of the quarter to those who fear God. Above all, he must fear God, since he will find himself face to face with death. And he shall not give a half or a quarter of his property except to those who are entitled to it, namely his children, the children of his children, his relatives, pilgrims, the most needy of the needy, or the worthy rather than the unworthy. And he must be a loyal and wise administrator, so that he may be worthy of praise and receive his reward from the heavenly judge. To him be praised. A Christian must not spend his property where there is no salvation. A testamentary disposition regarding a portion in excess of the half and of the quarter of his estate at his disposal shall be of no effect unless the disposition favors his heirs at law who are entitled to inherit after his death. And what he gave in his lifetime, such as manumission to a slave, a charitable legacy, alms, or donations, either when he was healthy or during a sickness, however not a sickness which causes intellectual deficiency, shall not form part of the half and the quarter of the estate left at his disposal. If a person has a child after the will has been made, the inheritance shall go to the one entitled to it, whether it be male or female. If a will is made without mention of the children, it is of no effect, because it transfers the succession from the children to non-relatives. If those who are entitled inherit are found, if those who are entitled to inherit are found among the male and female children, and if the will was made in favor of one who is not the testator's child, it is void after the testator's death, with respect to the one in whose favor it was made. It is proper that the children's children inherit from their grandparents. If the persons found who are entitled to succeed the testator are his relatives, and the will was made in favor of non-relatives, the former shall succeed to the half of the property. If the previously appointed heirs were his relatives, the succession shall be divided equally between those relatives and the ones who were found, and the position of the former heir with respect to ones who were found shall be determined by this rule. If the testator bequeaths a flock of sheep to his heirs, and the sheep multiply, it is to their benefit. Similarly, if the flock is diminished until only one sheep remains, or if completely destroyed, the loss is theirs. If the testator leaves a house to the heir and it burns down, the land belongs to him. And if the testator bequeaths a slave and his profits to you, but sets him free after making the will, or exchanges him for another, or sends him away to other parts, or the slave dies, then neither the slave nor his profit belong to you. If there are no roots, nothing connected with the roots can be left. And if the testator leaves any part of his estate to his heirs, for instance, a third or a fourth part of it, and then half of his estate is lost, the heirs shall receive one third or one quarter of what is left. If the testator has left to a person some part of his property specifying its quality, the heir at law may not prevent this person from taking what was destined for him. But if the testator has not specified its quality and his estate was made up of various things, the heir may choose either to give the person a portion of the estate, provided that he does not choose a bad portion, but rather a portion of middle value, or to give him the price it fetches. If it is an object which cannot be divided, he shall give him the price without quarreling about its value. The testator may validly bequeath to one the ownership of an object and to another benefit derived from that object, such as its fruit or the profit, like rent, wages, service for 1, 2, or 3 years according to the terms of an agreement, product yielded in one season, or rent for a definite period of time. After this, the use of the object is to be returned to the owner, that is, to the one to whom the testator bequeathed it. If one to whom the testator has bequeathed the benefit dies, the benefit shall not devolve upon his heirs. The first owner shall have the right to set the slave free, to sell or give him away as alms, or to give him to someone else after the period fixed for the benefit of the second owner expires. It is also valid to make a will bequeathing a woman slave to the exclusion of her unborn child, or to bequeath only the unborn child to the exclusion of the slave. If the testator bequeaths to his heir a pregnant slave without making any mention of the unborn child, or made the will before she became pregnant, both the woman and the unborn child belong to the heir. Section 5. The administrator appointed by the will. He must have two qualities, loyalty and ability in the administration of that over which he has power. If the testator himself has not specified a person to be administrator, the judge shall appoint one after his death. If the administrator does not have the required experience, his appointment is valid for certain matters only, to the exclusion of others. If the testator wants to entrust his entire estate to such an administrator, he must appoint two. Neither of them shall act without the order of the other, nor shall either of them usurp the duties of the other. And if it is said, either the one or the other, the one who accepts the appointment first or administers the estate first is the one who commands and not the other. If it is said, A, and after him B, the second may assume the administration only if the first leaves it. The orders of the second shall not be accepted unless this occurs. After the administrator actually has assumed the administration, he must accept the will, and shall not leave his duties under it before the heir attains majority and is well trained. Or, if he refuses, the heir may bring him before the judge, who shall reconcile them. The judge shall release the administrator from his duties only if he finds someone to replace him, or if the administrator tells the judge the reason for his refusal, which may be a prolonged illness, imprisonment that lasts a long time, a journey to a distant place, or exile. The judge shall not release him if he cannot replace him with another loyal and experienced administrator, or shall release him only after fixing a definite period of time, after which he shall come back and take over the administration. Once released, the administrator shall not retake the administration. The administrator released on the grounds mentioned earlier may retake the administration with the permission of the judge. If the person appointed by the judge is a true and firm believer, loyal, experienced, and a relative of the heir, he is the proper person to be appointed administrator. The judge shall appoint as administrator a relative of the heir, so that a kinsman may administer the property of his kinsman. A man may authorize his son to make his will, give him power over his property, and appoint him administrator of his succession. He may entrust the administration of his succession to his slave, who must do whatever the master would normally do. If a woman makes a will in favor of the children of her son, she may not appoint another as administrator and guardian, because their father is the proper person to be appointed to such duties. If they have no father to take over the administration and guardianship, she must appoint an administrator and one who takes care of what she bequeathed to them. If someone dies intestate, leaving children, and is survived by parents and brothers, the parents shall have power over his succession and shall administer it as if they were duly appointed. The brothers of the deceased may not share the succession with his children, nor may they oppose their parents. It is obvious that the term Azazi in this section does not mean Ausrasi, the testator, but the administrator, because both could not be called Azazi. Mac 3. If one writes the name of the heir and of the and of his administrator in the will, the judges shall divide his succession among his children, and the administrator shall not be given anything. If the testator does not make a will, and his heirs have a brother over 25 years of age, the latter shall be appointed administrator. If they have no elder brother, the wisest of their paternal uncles shall be appointed administrator and overseer of their affairs. He shall maintain them with the estate left by their father, according to their deeds, and make a written inventory of everything left them by their father. An account of everything shall be kept in a book. If they have no wise paternal uncles, the wisest of their paternal cousins over 25 years of age shall be the administrator. If they have no paternal cousins and their mother wishes to manage their affairs herself, she shall make this known to the judge, who shall make her take a vow not to get married until the children grow up. When they have grown up, she shall give them their inheritance. If she does not wish to assume the administration, our law provides that the elders of the city must appoint guardians and administrators for orphans and agree with them about the compensation to be given them in proportion to the property left by the deceased. After agreement is reached, the administrators shall take everything handed over to them by the elders. They shall look after the orphans properly, carefully, until they transfer it to them upon their attaining majority. The heir shall not require the administrator or the overseer appointed by the testator to produce a guarantor for his administration, because it was the owner of the property who entrusted the administration to him until his son attained majority. The male remains under the power of the administrator until he is 14, and the female until she is 12 years old. Once they attain these respective ages, they shall be freed from his power and come under the power of the overseer until they become 25 years of old, whereupon they will be able to manage their own affairs. One may be released from the duty of administrator on two grounds. The first is, if a person has 5 children, male and female, and wishes to avoid being appointed testamentary administrator for his relatives or orphans unrelated to him, he may be excused. But if he has less than 5 children, the judge shall compel him to be administrator or overseer for relatives and unrelated orphans. The second is, one who is administrator for orphans may not be released from his duties if he clearly accepted the testamentary disposition and some unforeseen calamity befell the property entrusted to him. The administrator appointed for the benefit of orphans may, with the permission of the judge, delegate some other person to look after his property. If it is ascertained that the testamentary administrator has failed in his duty to the orphans, neglecting their custody, what is left of the succession shall be entrusted to the administrators of the church until the orphans become adults. God forbids the administrators to spend the property entrusted to them unduly and make the orphans fall into misery. The administrator of the guardian may not sell anything that belongs to the orphans, give tribute, or pay off debts without the authorization and order of the judge to sell. But with the proper authorization, he may sell enough to give tribute or pay off a debt. A soldier or a minister of the king may not be appointed guardian and administrator for orphans unless he leaves the king's service. The end of the next chapter on succession deals with the wills of bishops, monks, slaves, and manumitted slaves. The patriarch Abba Kerrios and his bishops have enunciated rules of succession different from those found in this chapter. Those rules, too, are acceptable because they were made by some of the former patriarchs and by wise men. One may follow those rules.